This picture was taken in the mid-80s of ASEAN scholars residing at the Hwa Chong Hostel in Singapore. As a former ASEAN scholar studying at Raffles Institution, Dr. Shankar Pasupathi had come to Singapore in 1984 as a Secondary 1 student at the age of 13. That period of his life helped him build close and lasting friendships with his fellow scholars as well as Singaporeans, which he has kept and cherishes till today.
That was the point of the ASEAN scholarship. But I guess when you bring people from different environments and you throw them in the same place, and you know they kind of live and grow up together, especially in their formative years, you know, their early teens, the early teen years at that point in time, that's a time when people just kind of bond because they need each other to survive. The relationships that I formed at that time when I came in as an ASEAN scholar are the strongest relationships that I have today.
The Singapore government offers the ASEAN scholarship to students of the 9 other ASEAN nations, awarded to students from junior high school to university. The scholarship not only seeks to equip them with important skills for their future, it also brings them together as part of an ASEAN community early in their lives.
Lau Kok Kiong was 15 when he was awarded the ASEAN scholarship in 1989. Now a father of two, Mr. Lau recalls that while he had obtained a better cultural understanding of the different ASEAN countries through his interactions with his peers, he had also realised that they were rather very similar.
Being part of this program really opens up this understanding. And actually, the more we interact with them, we realise that we are so similar when initially we thought that we are so different. And in the end, we just get together, play a game of football or basketball with each other, and actually you see no difference at all.
In the boarding school, we actually have this event called International Night, whereby different nationalities actually showcase what their culture is by putting up performances. I was able to understand that actually we are quite similar in terms of our culture.
When you bring young people from the different countries together to really interact with each other, that is putting the face behind the flag. So it's not just knowing about a country in the abstract, but really having a friend, as it were, from that country, and understanding that country's history, geography, religious situation, and cultural situation through the lens of your interaction with a person from that country.
Besides scholarship programs, students from individual schools in Singapore take part in collaborations with schools in another ASEAN country. Gan Eng Seng Secondary School, for instance, as part of the Singapore-Thailand Enhanced Partnership or STEP program, has a strong partnership with Suan Kulap Wittayalai School, the oldest public secondary school in Thailand.
So through this twinning program, it gives the students an opportunity to apply what they have learned about Singapore, about ASEAN countries, through forming friendships with their Thai buddies, immersing themselves in the Thai school system, which I think has developed in them a greater sensitivity to other cultures and other customs.
My overall experience has been a unique and fulfilling one, as the different components of the program actually help make this possible, like the homestay and the camp, as well as the immersion.
I think one thing I've learned about Thai culture is that they are really warm and welcoming. So one aspect would be the homestay. When I went to their home, they actually welcomed me very warmly. They were really friendly toward me. They actually treated me like I was one of their own children.
What I have here is one of the souvenirs that my Thai buddy gave me. It is a photo that symbolizes our friendship that we made during the camp.
I get to learn more about their history and also get to interact with people from the locals there actually. And this is not something that I would actually do if I was just a normal tourist.
Students from Anglo-Chinese Junior College too obtain a rich understanding of life in neighbouring ASEAN countries when they take part in community building efforts overseas. Participating in such projects can also prove to be a transformative experience.
The objective of the overseas program is really to help our students understand more about overseas communities, also for them to both serve and to learn from the process. The Cambodia program is with one of our partners, the Methodist School of Cambodia. It has been ongoing for about 2 years because it really allowed us to learn more about the real needs of the Cambodian community, such that we can serve in a capacity that helps them to meet their needs.
One campus house students from about the ages of 7 to about 18. So the older students tend to look out more for the younger students. And also for myself, because I have siblings and I also have juniors, it made me want to look out more for my juniors and also show more care and concern for them. And through this trip, I learned that I was more inspired to learn more about the Cambodian culture.
Individual students can also play their part in fostering better cultural understanding. Ms. Vendela, a Singapore Management University student who hails from the Philippines, has organized business and cultural trips to Manila to dispel misconceptions about the Philippines and to help her peers better understand Filipino culture.
Overall, the feedback was very good. I was quite pleased. People even expressed interest in participating in Barkada, SMU Barkada, which is the Filipino Cultural Club events in the future. But probably the most touching thing was one of the participants after the trip. She wrote an email to the OrgCom and myself expressing her gratitude to us as a team for giving her the opportunity to explore the Philippines through our lenses and to get to go on such a trip.
I think all these scholarships and the interactions that are being facilitated under different regional and bilateral processes do help. They may seem disparate activities if you look at them in the individual context, but put together, they are all trying to achieve what the aim of ASEAN has been, to really bring the people of the different member countries together in this shared endeavor.
Whether it is a scholarship program or a study trip or an education forum, all these different efforts taken as a whole bring young minds in ASEAN together. And as they understand each other's cultures better and forge closer bonds, there is much promise of a more cohesive, integrated ASEAN as it heads into the next half century.
They may be small or often family-run businesses and usually hire fewer than 200 employees, yet they are certainly mighty. Small and medium enterprises, or SMEs for short, form the backbone of ASEAN's economies, accounting for more than 96% of all businesses in member states. In Singapore, there are about 188,000 SMEs, mainly in the manufacturing, retail, and business services sectors. In total, they contribute to about half of the country's gross domestic product.
But mighty as they are, SMEs face an uphill task in today's competitive business environment. The challenges usually boil down to their size and limited resources. So what can be done to help them? Well, for SMEs in ASEAN nations, the solution may lie in the newly launched ASEAN Economic Community, or AEC for short.
The AEC was formed in December 2015 to pave the way for greater integration among SME owners. It strives to create a single market and production base among the 10 member states by standardizing economic regulations, including those on trade, capital flow, and labor migration. This way, SMEs relying on raw materials from an ASEAN neighbor will benefit from more affordable goods as tariffs come down. Companies will also find it easier to export their goods and at lower cost in view of lower tariffs and simplified custom procedures.
There are initiatives from all the ASEAN countries to remove barriers to trade and definitely opens up a lot more opportunities in the free flow of goods and people around the region. At the same time, some 300 standards have been harmonized. Now with harmonization standards, now, for example, labeling can be simpler because they could be accepted across the different countries versus having labels for individual countries, which is very complex. So we can achieve the economic scale in reaching out to more countries in the ASEAN member states.
More than 90% of the high priority measures under the AEC's 2015 blueprint have since been implemented. The ASEAN SME Agency's working group is responsible for SME development and promotion in the region. For several years already, it has been making efforts to reach out and educate SMEs, such as organizing workshops, seminars, and outreach events. Also published the ASEAN SME Guidebook, as well as a directory of more than 800 outstanding SMEs in the region.
We also look at developing a strategic action plan and created a whole list of initiatives and strategic goals to see how can we help SMEs to reach out to countries, at the same time look at talent development, access to talents, as well as different ways of collaboration.
And it certainly makes sense for SMEs to reach out across ASEAN. It is the world's seventh largest economy, home to some 620 million people, and has a GDP of about $2.7 trillion. In Singapore, latest trade figures also showed that Southeast Asia has overtaken the United States to become the largest market for the country's goods and services. One company eyeing this is Chi Sing Oil, a family business in Singapore currently run by the third generation. The SME has been producing sesame oil since 1956, which it sells under three labels. The brand is widely recognized, but the company admits the AEC will result in even greater competition. Yet, Chi Sing feels this can also spur it to strengthen its regional presence and improve overall turnover.
We will be able to tap on this AEC to go into all these new markets as an integrated one. To go into all these countries actually is not easy because food palate is totally different. Everyone eats different styles of dishes. By working with our business partner, they will understand their market better than we do, and they will be able to create new recipes that suit to their food culture.
Like most SMEs, Chi Sing faces its fair share of challenges. In Singapore, various initiatives have been launched to help these companies upgrade, innovate, and stay relevant. Spring Singapore schemes, for example, which include grants, tax incentives, and loans, supported more than 18,000 enterprises in 2015. One such scheme is the Capability Development Grant. Chi Sing tapped it last year to automate the factory, increasing productivity to almost 400%. From 8 staff, the work now requires just 5, allowing the company to redeploy the rest to other duties. A recent Ministry of Trade and Industry report noted that companies who use this grant for technology innovation projects saw their revenues increase by almost 8%. Concerns remain that the increased competition from the single market inevitably means that some SMEs will be left behind. To make it more convenient for small business owners to get advice, SME centres have been set up since 2013, some located in the suburbs. Here, they can receive free information about the grants and schemes available and learn about ways to increase their revenues. Joining forces with other firms could also be one solution to overcome business challenges, but it's an idea which smaller SMEs may need some convincing. Another area to explore is the e-commerce market, which may help smaller firms reach out to IT-savvy customers.
It's also a great opportunity because that means you can sell your products and services 24/7 as well, right? Not limited to the store operation hours. That's the reason why we focus on this area, to customize a masterclass, particularly for the SMEs and micro SMEs, to help them to learn about e-commerce in the correct way so that they are more informed to consider using e-commerce as a means to help them, you know, develop their business and to improve their business performance.
While it's still early days, significant gains have already been made under the ASEAN Economic Community, and the region is already looking to its next target, the 2025 Blueprint. One of the areas experts believe should be closely looked at is the role of non-tariff barriers, as many feel they present one of the biggest obstacles to the success of the AEC. So to help SMEs reap the full benefits of regional integration, the group will seek to remove them and at the same time encourage sustainable growth and find innovative ways to drive new businesses.
From hawker centres to restaurants, with the abundant and diverse range of cuisines available, it is no wonder that Singapore is widely known as a food paradise. But even as we tuck in, how many of us have ever wondered where the food we eat comes from, or pondered over what would happen if one day this supply runs out? It may look like an implausible situation, but the issue of food security is emerging as a serious threat in many parts of the world. Experts say population and income growth, changing dietary habits, rising urbanization, as well as climate change are among the reasons that impact global food production. The problem has also led to food prices becoming volatile. And the Asian Development Bank estimates that for every 10% food price increase, up to 64 million people are likely to be pushed into the hunger trap. But just what is food security? It is defined as the availability and access to sufficient, safe, and nutritious food that can meet a population's dietary needs and food preferences.
The importance of food is very much derived from how we produce it and who produces it for us. Whereas there are about 100 million smallholder farmers just in Southeast Asia, but globally there are about 500 million smallholder farmers, and they support one third of the world. And if we don't make sure that they're producing the right amount of food and the right quantity, but also with the right nutrition balance, the right availability, then one, we're not going to meet the needs of the 9 billion people that we will be by 2050.
By then, ASEAN, currently home to more than 600 million people, is expected to see food demand increase by as much as 40%. The challenge is whether crop yield increases will be sufficient enough to feed the population by 2050. Aware of the importance of food security, the ASEAN community has long joined forces to ensure that the issue remains a permanent and high priority one.
In 1979, the Agreement on ASEAN Food Security Reserve was signed, allowing member nations to set aside and share rice stock should the need arise. After the food price crisis struck about 8 years ago, the ASEAN Integrated Food Security Framework was launched. This led to the establishment of the ASEAN Plus 3 Emergency Rice Reserve, which also includes China, Japan and South Korea as members.
Today, ASEAN has policies supporting agricultural innovation and sustainable food trade, in addition to information systems to forecast, plan, and monitor food supplies. That rice features as a key crop is no surprise, considering that half of the world's population eats the grain. It is also a main staple food among Asians, and according to the Food and Agriculture Organization, the region cultivates some 90% of the global rice supply. But being able to produce one's own food does not necessarily equate to being more food secure. Take the annual Global Food Security Index, developed by the Economist Intelligence Unit. It studies which countries are most food secure, by measuring the core issues of affordability, availability and quality across 113 nations. This year, Singapore is ranked third behind the United States and Ireland, putting it ahead of other major food-producing countries. The island has to rely almost entirely on food imports, and yet it managed to achieve this largely by boosting the resilience of its food supply.
Singapore did generally well in all three categories, particularly in of late the improvement in availability. To achieve that, we actually have basically four approaches. The four approaches are basically through diversifying our food sources, encouraging our local farmers to increase their local production. The third is actually to be very much plugged in into the global scene in terms of food supply, food security, agriculture issues. And finally, the element of having an integrated approach when it comes to food safety.
Guarding Singapore's food security is the mandate of the Agri-Food and Veterinary Authority, or AVA for short. This heavy dependence on the food trade means the country is highly exposed to the global price and supply fluctuations. So one of AVA's key strategies is diversification, where it sources a wide variety of food from some 160 countries. Another strategy is to ramp up local production.
We envision our farms of the future to be high-tech, innovative, highly intensive, and productive, able to do more with less.
Support from AVA comes in the form of its $46 million Agriculture Productivity Fund. Farmers can tap the scheme to purchase systems to help them modernize and improve capabilities. Sing Chun Farm, for example, has egg grading and sorting machines, as well as a robot cleaner to automatically clean its hen cages, while Sky Green's vertical farming system allows it to grow up to 3,000 tons of vegetables a year, 10 times more than on the same area of land using conventional farming methods. Aside from ensuring access to food, Singapore makes sure that what it imports is safe to eat. Its comprehensive system includes accreditation and regulations. Inspections are also done on sales sites, in addition to safety tests in laboratories. On the international front, Singapore keeps abreast with global developments regarding food security. In 2013, the country joined the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, allowing it to better anticipate potential supply disruptions and be more prepared should a food-related crisis occur. ASEAN members also hold discussions on a regular basis. In October, Singapore hosted the 38th meeting of the ASEAN Ministers on Agriculture and Forestry, the highest body handling cooperation in food, agriculture and forestry matters.
Put in place the necessary systems, structures, to make sure that we don't become food insecure. We will in all ways make sure that it's not just about our food security, but it's the food security of a region. And I would even go so far as to say that it's also global food security because we are so connected.
Singapore could serve as an example of how a country does not need to attain self-sufficiency in order to be food secure. Food security depends on many factors: domestic production and imports, effective distribution, diversified food sources, as well as good planning, among others.
As today's environment becomes increasingly complex and uncertain, all countries, including Singapore, will need to keep developing new strategies to find solutions and increase efforts in prioritizing investments in food security-related measures.